I'm the president of the Harden County Players. For those of you who are outside and we do not have room, please know that we are doing this performance again at 2 p.m. It takes about 25 minutes. If there's not enough room in here now and you'd like to come back, we are doing the exact same performance at 2 o'clock on the dot. Like I said, it takes about 25 minutes. Okay? We'll try to get in as many as we can. Ladies and gentlemen, as we are doing a reenactment of this, just like in a regular courtroom, we ask that all cell phones be put on vibrate or turned off. I would say pagers, but pagers are completely outdated. If you have a pager, God bless you for keeping up with old times. But we need to go ahead and have that on vibrate or silenced as well.
We have one seat, one lonely seat right here. Is anybody single by themselves?
Are you sure?
Yes. You seem very upset.
I am. I just can't believe this poor dog.
Very, very upset.
Yeah, is there anything you can do to make your stay more pleasant? It's okay.
Okay,
well, ma'am, we can only recite the facts as they stand. There's nothing else that we can do. Please try to be calm. Understand that we are just trying to, I know, take a deep breath, honey, take a deep breath. If you need a paper bag, we can get one of those, okay? Just remember, this is the 1950s. There we go, okay.
Greetings, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the year 1957. In the rich history that is Hardin County and Kenton, Ohio, there have been many cases that resonate in the halls of this courthouse and in the community as a whole. Some are mundane, some are exciting, and some even make national headlines. You are about to witness such a case in the matter of Hardin County versus Annie the St. Bernard. Shh! Court is about to begin.
All rise.
Please be seated.
Today is May 20th, the year 1957, and court is ready to hear the case of Hardin County versus Annie the St. Bernard. The Honorable Judge Arthur Tudor presiding. Would counsel rise and identify themselves, please?
Your Honor, my name is Paul McKinley. I am the District Attorney for Hardin County. I'm here to represent Mr. Patrick, our dog warden, and Mr. Emerson, a little sheep farmer.
Your Honor, my name is Charles Leese, defense attorney for Joanna Perkins, the owner of the St. Bernard known as Annie the defendant.
Thank you, gentlemen. I know jury selection is done prior to the case commencing, but as these circumstances are unusual, and there are some new faces in the gallery, at this time I am requiring that a jury be selected from those in the gallery before us. Mr. McKinley, would you please pick three people out to sit in the jury box to hear the case?
Of course, Your Honor.
Me?
Thank you, Mr. McKinley. Mr. Leeds, would you please pick out three people from those in attendance to sit as our jury?
Of course I would, Your Honor. Would you like to join the jury? Please be number five. Ma'am, would you like to be in the jury? Go ahead. Sure, as you can say, thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen. I figure with each of you picking out half the jury, there will be no bickering or favoritism showing. Of course, you're both attorneys, so I wouldn't expect any arguments until the case commences, that is. And on that note, Mr. McKinley, will you please present your case?
Your Honor, we are here today on this matter as a temporary injunction, which was filed by the defense to prevent the dog warden from euthanizing the accused animal known as Annie. Now, the accused was seized as part of an investigation to the death of six sheep by a local farmer, Mr. Emerson. Now, at this time, we would like to call Mr. Emerson Fay to the stand.
Mr. Fay, please take the stand.
Please raise your right hand. Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
You may be seated.
Please proceed, Mr. McKinley.
Mr. Fay, can you please relate the events that transpired on the evening of February 24, 1957?
Yeah, I can. Oh, you mean right now?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. It was at night, and my son heard a terrible commotion going on out where the sheep are. So we went running out there. We found six of our sheep laid slain in their pen. Now, running away from the scene, we saw this big St. Bernard and a little yellow mongrel dog. I ain't seen nothing like that in all my years.
In your opinion, were these two dogs responsible for the deaths of those animals?
Oh, yeah. There was no other animals around, and they were running away, so it was easy to assume that they were the ones responsible.
Did you report the deaths of the death of a sheep at your farm?
Well, yeah. I called the dog warden, Raymond Hattery, and told him what had happened. It was a couple of days later I found out that he took the St. Bernard in custody for disposal.
What do you mean by disposal?
Well, you see, there's kind of an unwritten law in farming in the sheeping community that if a dog has killed any of your livestock, then you have the right to have that animal destroyed so they won't do it again.
And is this a well-known unwritten rule? Is it also in the farming community?
Well, yes, sir, it is.
Oh, well, thank you, Mr. Fay. Your Honor, I have no further questions for this witness.
Mr. Lees, would you care to cross-examine?
Yes, Your Honor, I would. Mr. Fay, good afternoon. First of all, I'd like to express my condolences for the loss of your animals. I know this hasn't been very easy for you. I just have a couple of questions.
Okay.
All right, the first one. Mr. Fay, do you recognize the dogs that were running away from the sheep area?
Well, there ain't that many St. Bernards running around the area that goes with the little yellow mongrel dog, so I called Ray Hattery and told him what the animal looked like.
And it was your intention to have the animal destroyed, is that true?
Oh, yes, sir. Until the owner, Joanna Perkins, got an injunction to the destruction of the dog.
You mean Annie?
Yeah, Annie, the St. Bernard.
Thank you, Mr. Fay. That's all I have, Your Honor.
Witness may step down. McKinley, please call your next witness.
Yes, Your Honor. This time we'd like to call Raymond Hattery.
Mr. Hattery, please take the stand.
Would you raise your right hand, please? Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
You may be seated.
Have a seat, Mr. Hattery.
Mr. Hatter, what is your current position?
Sitting. I'm the dog warden of Hart County.
At the time you received the call from Mr. Bay, were you able to locate the animal based on the description he had given?
Yes, sir. I found the animal the day after the attack. It was tied up in the front lawn of Miss Joanna Perkins. I took possession of the animal, and I took it to Doc Pleasant's place, where he inspected it and tested her for rabies.
Now, what was your understanding of what was to happen to the dog, Mr. Hadley?
Well, I thought the dog was going to be destroyed. That's usually what's done in these cases, so I didn't see why this should be treated any differently.
Thank you, Mr. Hadley. No further questions, Your Honor.
Mr. Least, would you care to cross-examine?
Not at this time, Your Honor.
Mr. Hadley, you may step down. Mr. McKinley, please call your next witness.
I have no further questions at this time, Your Honor. The seat rests.
Mr. Lease, you may call your first witness.
At this time, Your Honor, we would like to call Mrs. Joanna Perkins.
Mrs. Perkins, please take your stand.
Raise
your right hand, please. Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth,
and nothing but the truth, so help you
God? I do.
Mr. Lease,
you may proceed.
Thank you, Your Honor. Mrs. Perkins, when was the first you had realized that Annie was being charged with the destruction of the 6 sheep owned by Mr. Emerson Fay?
When Ray Hattery came to my place to get Annie, I told him that he couldn't just come in and take her because she doesn't really belong to me. She belongs to my son, Gene.
And where is your son this time?
He's stationed in Augsburg, Germany. He's a paratrooper in the United States Army. In fact, the Army Times took up a collection to raise some money to bring him back here for this trial, but he couldn't make it. They didn't make enough money.
That's too bad, Mrs. Perkins. When you learned that Annie was to be examined and destroyed, what did you do about it?
Well, through you, of course, I filed an injunction with the court to stop the destruction of our dog. It didn't seem fair that they could just come onto my property and take her without any proof or anything like that.
Thank you, Ms. Perkins.
I have nothing else, Your Honor.
Mr. McKinley, would you care to inquire?
No questions at this time, Your Honor.
Mrs. Perkins, you may step down. Please call your next witness.
Your Honor, at this time, I would like to call Mr. George Pleasant to the stand. Thank you, Your Honor. Mr. Pleasant, what is your occupation, please?
I'm a veterinarian.
And you were the one who took possession of Annie, the St. Bernard, from Mr. Hatterick?
I did.
And did you perform an examination of Annie?
Yes, I did. The examination was completed on February 28th. At that time, she didn't have rabies. She was well cared for, and all results were normal.
At this time, did you find anything that would indicate that she had had any run-in with any other animals?
No, sir. There was no wool in her fur, no blood on her muzzle or in her teeth, and nothing around her paws that would indicate anything out of the ordinary.
Thank you, Dr. Pleasant. Nothing further, Your Honor.
Mr. McKinley, would you care to examine?
No questions at this time, Your Honor.
Can you step down? Mr. Lee, please call your next witness.
We have no further witnesses, Your Honor. The defense rests.
At this time, the case belongs to the jury. You will have time to deliberate the case and find either the state or the county or for the defense, Annie the St. Bernard. Normally, we would have you deliberate in a special room, but as time is of the essence, you will receive some final instructions from the announcer, and we'll render your decision accordingly. Announcer finished instructing the jury?
Yes, sir.
Has the jury reached a decision?
We have, Your Honor.
What say you?
We find for the state.
Oh, no.
Your Honor, this is a travesty. I demand you pull the jury.
Juror number one, how do you find?
I find for the state.
Juror number two, how do you find?
I find for the state.
Oh.
Juror number three, how do you find?
I find for the state.
Oh, no.
Juror number four. How do you find?
Your Honor, I find for the state.
Oh, no.
Juror number five. How do you find?
I find for the state.
Jurors number six and seven.
See, now that's justice right there.
Well, there you have it, Mr. Lease. The jury has been polled and the decision is unanimous. And on a personal note, I must say that the people of Hardin County have never looked better. At this point, the jury is dismissed and you may rejoin your loved ones in the gallery.
Hey, you're not the one that had six sheep slain either. Justice
but
is justice.
But there was no proof.
There is no proof.
Court's court.
No evidence.
No evidence at all.
Is that
just assumption.
It is the decision of this court that at this time we approach the gallery and talk to these fine people gathered here today. Finding for the state, it was the decision of this court that a temporary injunction to the destruction of the junk dog Annie be dissolved. This decision was made partly to what is deemed to be cheap publicity that surrounded the case and the participants. It was at this point that the dog could be destroyed by the Hardin County Dog Warden for the destruction of Faye's sheep.
And it was our decision, my sons and mine, to appeal the jury's decision, no matter how cute they are.
Yay.
With the help of my attorney, and we continue to fight for Annie. We were willing to take it to the Supreme Court if need be.
We filed an appeal, and the case went before the 3rd District Court of Appeals in Lima, Ohio. Now, the issue was that today is May 20th, 1957, and it wouldn't be until March 12th, 1958, that the appeals court made a decision to have an official hearing on the matter.
It would be another 2 months before the case was heard and the evidence was presented to the Court of Appeals. The case was finally heard on May 14, 1958. The 3-judge panel consisted of the Honorable Raymond Younger, the Honorable Thomas Guernsey, and the Honorable George Middleton.
The arguments for the defense, the Perkins, was that there was a case in Indiana in which the state statute, which is the same as in Ohio, held that except where the dog is caught in the act of killing a farm animal, can the dog be killed by someone other than the master? If it is determined the dog caused the death of another animal after the death had occurred, then it was the right of the dog's master and their right alone to destroy the animal.
The defense also argued that because she was licensed, she couldn't be considered a stray and therefore was protected under certain rights that the master of that animal has. The prosecution, Mr. McKinley's team, claimed that an unwritten law in sheeping communities would supersede the law when such overwhelming evidence was presented as to who the offender was. In this case, a 105-pound St. Bernard. It wouldn't be until June 3rd, 1958, 3 weeks after the case was heard, that the appeals court handed down its decision.
A unanimous decision was made to free Annie.
Yay! Yay!
The defense had won its appeal. One of the interesting facts is that Annie wasn't actually freed until July 17th, 1958, to her owner, Jean Perkins, who had finally returned from Germany. The reason for that was that during this entire ordeal, Annie had been kenneled at Dr. Pleasant's facility, and there was a balance due.
Hey, I paid the first 6 months of the housing fee. I didn't feel I should pay the $170 balance remaining since we had won our case.
Right.
Yeah. I didn't want to be a devil about it. I just wanted to make sure I was compensated for my expenses.
Yeah, yeah.
The attorneys got their money.
Of course.
In the end, Dr. Pleasant settled for $100 of the $170 and called the account square. The $100 was paid out by the Hardin County Animal Protective Association. The association was an endeavor created by Mrs. Perkins' neighbors and friends to support her cause. The payment to Dr. Pleasant was approved by the president of the association at that time, one Mrs. Heber Clay from Ada, Ohio.
The final entry was that Kenton held its first annual pet parade on July 31st that year. Annie was the honorary marshal.
Yay!
Ladies and gentlemen, that was a quick summary of the events that unfolded in Kenton during 1957 and 1958. Kenton and Hardin County continue to have a rich history with some of the greatest people, and I'm glad we got to share our story with a few of them here today. Thank you for attending and have a joyous day.